Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Shifting 21st Century Presidency, Assessing the Implications for America and the World, by Tevi Troy, narrated by Jonathan Sleep. Introduction. The Rapidly Changing 21st Century Presidency, Tevi Troy. The presidency is an important and quintessential U.S. institution. It can tie Americans together, lead America through times of crisis, and help to steer America away from authoritarianism on the right and socialism on the left. To do this, the presidency must maintain both its potency and its credibility. A weakened presidency can do very little, while a president without the respect of the American people is destined to fail. For our nation to succeed, the presidency must maintain its characteristics as a respected American institution. Unfortunately, the presidency has taken some severe blows to its credibility in recent decades. Donald Trump was a norm-breaking president in a variety of ways, but he is far from alone in breaking established presidential practices in this century. Barack Obama had a pen-and-a-phone presidency in which he promoted the use of executive orders and administrative action to accomplish what he could not get passed legislatively, even when he had previously said it was unconstitutional to do so. For his part, George W. Bush, with Congress, reorganized government to create the Homeland Security State in the wake of the September 11, 2001 terrorist attacks. He also alienated Democrats with his use of signing statements to explain his administration's interpretation of what legislation meant and how the administration would implement bills that had become law. And Joe Biden has sought to create New Deal or Great Society level changes of both a programmatic and a structural nature, with far narrower legislative majorities than those enjoyed by ambitious presidents Franklin Roosevelt and Lyndon Johnson. Furthermore, Biden declared a $500 billion student loan forgiveness program despite the fact that House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, a fellow Democrat, specifically said that the executive branch lacked the power to do this. The breaking of norms by each president in question is not necessarily alike. Some scholars have argued that Trump's actions were the equivalent of amending the informal Constitution in at least five significant ways. All presidents who have followed George Washington have either gone along with or away from the precedents that he established. With the 21st century now more than 20% completed, and in the context of a divided federal government and populace, it is important to look at the changes to the presidency that three consequential but imperfect presidencies have brought. As a result of the changes wrought by three very different presidents, the presidency inhabited by Joe Biden was significantly different in many ways than the presidency Bill Clinton left at the beginning of 2001. Although the presidency has always evolved, the rapidity of change in just the first fifth of the 21st century is remarkable. Part of these changes stem from the numerous crises of this young century. 9/11 and the resulting global war on terrorism, Hurricane Katrina, the Great Recession, the coronavirus pandemic, and the urban unrest of 2020. Crisis always brings with it rapid change, but there are other factors at work as well. Increased polarization has led presidents of both sides of the aisle to press existing rules and norms to their limits in the short windows allotted to them. And advances in technology, with the development of America as an impatient nation, means that leaders feel the pressure to get more done during their tenures. Norms and rules be damned. The result is a lot of policy and structural change in a short period, including new cabinet departments, new election rules, and significantly increased spending and debt, among other things. For the most part, these changes have occurred with little thought to what it all means for the functionality and stability of our democratic institutions and processes, and, consequently, our nation's capacity to address the needs as well as aspirations of the American people. These significant changes to the presidency are accretive. As the presidency gains more power, it can use that power to implement further expansions of the presidency and changes to our governing structures. The changes also raise the question, is the presidency as currently configured reflective of its intended role as an American institution? A number of scholars on the right, including Chris DeMuth and Yuval Levin, both of whom have worked in the White House, have argued that Congress has ceded too much power to the executive. Congress passes broad laws, but then leaves the details of the legislation to be worked out via regulation by the executive branch. Furthermore, Congress seems increasingly reluctant or unable to legislate, which leaves it to the executive branch to do more and more by executive action, an approach contrary to the one envisioned by the founders. At this point, 20-plus years into the 21st century, it is an appropriate time to look back at the recent changes and see if they are what Congress and the American people want, and if they correspond to the framers' original vision of the presidency in our constitutional system. Many of these 21st century changes have taken place in the wake of a crisis and in the midst of partisan warfare, so our nation has not taken stock of what the changes in toto mean for our polity and our nation. Examining these issues can help inform Congress, presidential aspirants, and the American people about the extent of the changes to our governing structures and begin to assess whether they have been helpful changes and what can be done to reassert the proper balance of power among the branches of government, if not. These questions are particularly important in light of the international challenges we as a nation face. After a few decades in which democracy appeared to be on the march, it has receded in recent years as more authoritarian systems in China and Russia have openly challenged American sovereignty. A system that relies too much on executive power and not enough on elected legislators has a weaker case to make in favor of the democratic way of life. Furthermore, the possibility of problematic leadership from the White House can affect America's global standing and its ability to make the case for democracy over authoritarianism. Looking at important questions like these can help us determine if the presidency is situated better or worse as a result of these changes to lead our nation and the world through an increasingly uncertain future. With the input of major presidential scholars, experts, and administration aides from both sides of the aisle, this book begins to address these important issues. The shifting 21st century presidency is based in part on the submitted papers and an edited version of the event proceedings of a series of conferences held at the Bipartisan Policy Center in the first half of 2022. The goal of this gathering of presidential scholars and experts was to further the mission of the Bipartisan Policy Center's Presidential Leadership Initiative by forming a deeper understanding of perhaps the most powerful institution of the federal government. This volume examines the outsized and growing influence of the presidency and questions whether that trend is healthy to democracy in the United States and around the world. The point of the effort is to make observations that engage and include both citizens and policymakers in the political process regarding the state of the presidency. The participants all either have studied the executive branch extensively or seen how it operates up close, while simultaneously having something original to say about it today. The aim of this project, then, is to allow them a platform to not only be contributors to this volume, but contributors to the discourse that impacts the direction of our nation. The Bipartisan Policy Center is uniquely situated to engage in this effort, as it is respected by and holds credibility across the political spectrum. Taking the ideas expressed in the chapters that make up this work and having them discussed by the authors should enhance the exposure of the recent developments regarding the modern presidency. As the presidency grows in scope, each president must juggle all of these increased responsibilities concurrently, potentially to the detriment of the ability to carry out the presidency's vast responsibilities in an effective manner. Regardless of party, the occupier of the White House and their administration must contend with battles being fought on many fronts. It is a necessity that the American public recognize this and be given the chance to reflect upon and determine if this is the government they want. With a populace that is continuously moving toward diverging poles, bringing luminaries from both sides together to discuss agreements on the job description and a rubric for grading of our presidents, launches an important re-examination of the presidency. This nascent effort will make this title unique and the reading experience enriching. Section 1. The Management of the Presidency in the 21st Century. My experience in the White House taught me that all White House work is funneled into two main buckets, president as decider and president as performer. The decider function is in essence about managing the vast apparatus that is the U.S. federal government. Managing this behemoth requires a host of complicated decisions constantly being made by increasingly senior federal officials. The most complex and consequential of these decisions get made by the President of the United States. The processes by which these decisions get made are a key part of the management of the executive branch, and the subjects covered in this section, executive function, transitions, and foreign policy, are essential components of that executive branch management. Chapter 1. Implementation Failure and Presidential Success. Elaine Kmark. In 1789, Thomas Jefferson wrote a letter to the Frenchman Abbe Arnaud in which he concluded that the execution of the laws is more important than the making of them. This has never been truer than it is now. In the 21st century presidency, which exists in a maelstrom of commentary, some of which is serious, some of which is nonsense, and most of which is polarized, it seems that presidential performance is assessed on an hourly basis. And yet, as the saying goes, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Even in an age of intense polarization, citizens' assessments of their presidents are fairly constant. Within what is a fairly narrow band, presidents suffer drops in their approval ratings, but some drops are larger than others and have longer-lasting and more serious consequences. These policy shifts are complicated by the development that when presidents suffer implementation failures, in simple language, when stuff goes wrong, it takes a toll on the public's perception of presidential competence. As we will see, presidents lose political capital when the governments they run face implementation failures. This happened to George W. Bush after Hurricane Katrina. It happened to Barack Obama after the failure of the healthcare websites. It happened to Donald Trump as he tried to navigate the COVID epidemic, and it has, once more, happened to Joe Biden in the wake of withdrawal from Afghanistan. In each instance, the political capital lost is nearly impossible to get back. For first-term presidents, implementation failures are major contributors to electoral failures. For second-term presidents, implementation failures eat up so much political capital that they are hobbled in their ability to enact the major changes they sought. George W. Bush and Katrina. Let's start with President George W. Bush's handling of Hurricane Katrina. On the afternoon of Friday, August 26, 2005, forecasters at the National Weather Service saw that a hurricane named Katrina was turning west. What they initially thought would be a Category 4 hurricane turned into a Category 5, and the mayor of New Orleans ordered the first-ever mandatory evacuation of the city. 24 hours later, things got even worse as the storm caused breaches in 53 different levees in the city, leaving 80% of the city underwater. Thus began a harried and ineffectual rescue effort that in the days that followed made the United States look like a third-world country. For weeks, the rest of America and the world was treated to photographs of devastation. While much of the middle class had heeded the mayor's warnings and gotten out of the city, the poor were left behind, out of cash and with no money for bus tickets or for gas if they happened to own a car. Since many poor people live from month to month on some form of government assistance, they'd run out of money by the time the storm hit. Some flocked to the Superdome, which within hours was overwhelmed with trash, backed up toilets, and desperate people. Others found themselves on rooftops, waving wildly at helicopters to be rescued from the rising waters. Emergency responders were themselves victims, and outside help was chaotic. The rescue efforts were characterized by confusion, delay, misdirection, inactivity, poor coordination, and a lack of leadership at all levels of government, according to a subsequent congressional report on the tragedy. As this was unfolding, President Bush traveled to New Orleans with the director of the Federal Emergency Management Agency, FEMA, Michael Brown, and uttered the words that would come back to haunt him. "Brownie, you're doing a heck of a job." 12 days later, Brownie was fired. The damage to the Bush presidency was significant and impossible to fix. Katrina happened during the first year of Bush's second term in office. Given that his first term goals had been upended by the attacks of 9/11 and the decision to go to war in Iraq, his second term offered an opportunity for him to make his mark on domestic policy. And unlike 2000, in 2004 he'd won a clean victory and control of both houses of Congress. He was thus poised to enact major policy. At the heart of his agenda was reform of Social Security through the establishment of personal savings accounts. As he began his second term, the White House outlined an ambitious campaign to convince the public and Congress of his plan. But after Hurricane Katrina, the political capital that he had intended to spend on this was gone. His approval ratings continued to deteriorate, the drive to reform Social Security fizzled, and Democrats won control of Congress in 2006 and the presidency in 2008. Obama and the crashing websites. Bush's successor, Barack Obama, used up a great deal of his first-term political capital passing the Affordable Care Act. In the 2010 midterms, Democrats lost control of the House of Representatives and nearly lost control of the Senate. Nonetheless, Obama was able to win re-election and a shot at fulfilling the remainder of his domestic agenda, which included action on climate change he had abandoned in his first term. And then, in the fall of 2013, came the rollout of his major legislative achievement, the Affordable Care Act, ACA. On October 1, 2013, millions of Americans in search of subsidized health insurance logged on to the new federal website, healthcare.gov, hoping to buy health insurance as easily as they could buy a plane ticket on Expedia or a book on Amazon. Or so they thought. Instead, to the dismay of millions of Americans shopping for subsidized health insurance, and to the surprise of President Obama and his top staff, the website crashed. Not once, not twice, but again and again and again over a period of 2 long months. The press erupted in a frenzy over the inability of the federal government with all its vast resources to build the website at the heart of President Obama's health care reforms. They were joined by a polarized citizenry, half of whom wanted to buy insurance and were endlessly frustrated, and half of whom saw the whole episode as yet more evidence that the government couldn't organize a two-car funeral. The impact on Obama's presidency was long-lasting. During the last 3 months of 2013, as stories about the troubled rollout of healthcare.gov dominated the news, Obama's ratings fell to their lowest point ever, with only 39.8% approving of the job he was doing as president and 55.9% disapproving, according to an average of polls compiled by Real Clear Politics. Not only did the implementation failure fuel continued opposition to the ACA into the 2014 elections, it gave Republicans more ammunition against the Democrats, which they used in 2014 to win 9 more seats in the Senate and 13 seats in the House. This further doomed a slew of the president's other second-term initiatives, including immigration reform, climate change legislation, and gun control. The most Obama could do on many of these issues was to issue executive orders that were quickly rescinded when Trump took office. By the time Obama handed over power to Trump, his approval ratings had improved somewhat, but precious time had passed. Like his predecessor, Obama's implementation failure ended any change to enact significant changes in his second term. Trump and COVID. Donald Trump was a controversial president from the start, so controversial that his approval ratings never went above 50% in his entire 4-year term in office. In fact, his average approval rating for his full term in office was the lowest since pollsters started measuring approval back when Harry Truman was president. But despite dismal approval ratings, an impeachment trial, and continuing controversy, his election year dawned, Trump's approval ratings ticked up, and his re-election looked increasingly likely. Part of this was due to uncertainty as to who the Democratic candidate would be. Joe Biden, the most electable Democrat in a general election, was stuck in the polls and looking like he wouldn't even win the Democratic nomination. The momentum seemed to be with Senator Bernie Sanders, a socialist who many considered a sure loser in November, despite temporarily polling well against Trump. Republicans were predicting Trump would survive because of the progressive overreach and a strong economy, not to mention the fact that the Electoral College, with its heavy overrepresentation of rural states, gave Republicans a strong advantage. In addition to surviving an impeachment attempt, Trump had passed a large tax cut bill. He had an enormous war chest, and he had a united party. But most importantly, he had a booming economy, low unemployment, steady growth, and a healthy stock market. By January, the number of people reporting that they were satisfied with the way things were going reached its highest point since 2005. Finally, he had the advantage of incumbency, and incumbents with strong economies rarely lose. And then came COVID. Trump's failures during the coronavirus pandemic ran the gamut from the rhetorical to the organizational. The White House Coronavirus Task Force was created on January 27, 2020, and chaired by Vice President Mike Pence. As the crisis deepened, Trump insisted on conducting a daily press conference on the situation himself. An anxious nation stuck at home, tuned in faithfully, looking for solid information and for hope. Yet all too often when Trump went out to speak to the public about the crisis, he added to the fear and chaos surrounding the situation. In the first month alone, he told Americans the pandemic was not serious by asserting his hunches about data. He assured people that everyone would be tested, even when there were very few tests available. He told people that we were very close to a vaccine when it was nearly a year away. He mistakenly asserted that goods as well as people from Europe would be forbidden from entering the United States. And he announced that Google had a website for testing, while the initiative was merely an unimplemented notion. After each televised gaffe, a presidential clarification was needed. Trump had the unique distinction of giving a national address meant to calm the country that had the effect of taking the stock market down over 1,000 points. But Trump's chaotic news conferences paled in comparison to the actual implementation missteps of his administration. The White House task force killed a plan to distribute masks to every household in America, a reflection of Trump's antipathy to masking. Trump refused to help governors who were in desperate need of ventilators, telling them that they should try getting it themselves. By April, in the absence of a coherent plan for managing the national stockpile, governors facing shortages of equipment, from ventilators to personal protective equipment, were left to figure it out. One of the most glaring deficiencies was the failure to have enough tests available to identify those infected and to screen others for possible exposure. South Korea, a country a fraction of the size of the United States, was testing thousands more people a day than the United States. The failure to produce tests quickly will go down as one of the biggest failures in the overall handling of this disease because it prevented authorities from understanding the scope of the pandemic, and therefore made it difficult for them to undertake appropriate steps to mitigate its spread. Once again, governors were on their own, left to develop their own tests after the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, belatedly removed regulatory barriers. The one bright spot in Trump's implementation efforts was the plan to speed up progress on getting a vaccine. Named Operation Warp Speed, the massive effort coordinated by the federal government to produce a vaccine was modeled on the World War II war mobilization effort. It was wildly successful in developing and manufacturing a vaccine in less than a year. Trump tried in vain to hurry up the announcement of the vaccine, but it was not ready until after Election Day. And then it took months before supplies and distribution got straightened out. But by that time, the election was over. In what was shaping up to be a very close election, Trump's trouble managing the pandemic had a big impact on his re-election prospects. In April, Trump's approval rating was 47.4%, one of the highest in his presidency. But by July, as the pandemic went on, and there was little or no tangible relief in sight, he suffered a 6.3% drop in the Real Clear Politics average of polls. Of course, the most important poll took place on Election Day. Most of the voters who voted for Biden were casting votes against his opponent. Fully 60% of voters on Election Day said that the recent rise in coronavirus cases was the most important factor, 23%, or an important factor, 37%, in their presidential vote. And an overwhelming number of those voters voted for Biden. Nearly half of all voters said that U.S. efforts to contain coronavirus are going very badly, 32%, or somewhat badly, 15%. And on the question of who could better handle the coronavirus pandemic, Biden ran 10 percentage points ahead of Trump. Biden and Afghanistan. So now we turn to Biden. Biden began his presidency with a string of wins. He passed a massive COVID relief package through Congress. Unlike Trump, who never fully embraced his powers, especially use of the Defense Production Act, Biden used that act and others to achieve large increases in vaccine production. The federal government increased the supply of vaccines, and by spring of Biden's first year in office, state governments were, with the help of the feds, figuring out how to more efficiently get vaccines into arms. As William A. Galston and I wrote in early May 2021, in the past 4 months, the COVID-19 vaccination campaign has gone from a desperate, chaotic search for scarce vaccines to enough vaccines for everyone who wants one. Thus, by the summer of his first year in office, Biden seemed to be doing fine. His approval rating stayed above the 50% mark. He appeared to be fulfilling the expectations of the voters who had voted for him. He was able to pass legislation providing massive amounts of pandemic relief to the public, although he did not get any Republican votes for it. And he was getting vaccines into people's arms. The summer promised a return to normalcy. But by August, the Biden administration was presiding over what looked to be a hasty and poorly planned exit from Afghanistan. For weeks in August, television footage of desperate Afghanis dominated the news. Many had cooperated in some way with the Americans during the long war with the Taliban, and we owed them protection against the Taliban with vindictive intentions. As they tried to get into the gate around the airport and board planes out of Afghanistan, Americans of a certain age were reminded of our equally chaotic withdrawal from Saigon at the end of the Vietnam War. The Afghanistan withdrawal marked one of those massive implementation failures from which presidents have a hard time recovering. In Virginia, Terry McAuliffe was running for a second term as governor, and his campaign reported that during the summer they began to see what they would later describe in a memo as a negative national climate, collateral damage from the chaotic Afghanistan withdrawal, among other issues. Consider what happened to Biden in his first year in office. Although his approval ratings had started to dip in the summer by August, his approval takes a dramatic dip downward as Americans are bombarded with news out of Afghanistan. Passage of the infrastructure bill in November is not sufficient to get his approval ratings back to where they were. By the beginning of his second year in office, Democrats were panicking over the upcoming midterm elections, and the Biden administration was promising a reset. But nothing seemed to be working. What is it about implementation failures? What is it about presiding over a major mess that is so damaging to the modern presidency? First and foremost, it erodes confidence in presidential competence. The fact is, Americans expect the president to actually run the executive branch of the government. When it fails, the buck stops here, as President Harry Truman used to say. Presidents have a hard time predicting, understanding, and dealing with implementation failures because in the modern presidency, they are far removed from the operational side of the vast federal government that they are supposed to be running. The Bush White House wasted several precious days before realizing that, during Hurricane Katrina, the first responders of New Orleans were also victims. No one in the Obama White House was charged with writing the flawed computer code that took down the websites and frustrated millions of insurance seekers, but he got the blame. President Trump and his inner circle could not analyze emerging data on the COVID virus that caused so much confusion, and neither Biden nor anyone in his inner circle had experience in the huge military and logistical effort that Afghanistan turned out to be. Writing in his autobiography after he had left office, Bush had this to say. Just as Katrina was more than a hurricane, its impact was more than physical destruction. It eroded citizens' trust in their government. It exacerbated divisions in our society and politics, and it cast a cloud over my second term. This could be said of the implementation failures of all of the 21st century presidents. In every implementation failure, it's not too long before the initial shock and reaction is traced to large and expensive pieces of the U.S. federal government that failed. The Federal Emergency Management Agency, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CMS, the CDC, and the State Department and military. In each instance, there were warning signs that never reached the White House, resulting in as much surprise in the White House as in the public at large. The difference being, of course, that the public assumes the president is in charge and should have known. Can implementation failures be prevented? The most common response of presidents to these large-scale failures is to concentrate on the unprecedented nature of the problem. A Category 5 hurricane, a national insurance market run by the government, a worldwide pandemic, a large-scale evacuation. Everyone who finds themselves in this situation wants to argue that nothing better could have been done. And yet, the irony of a large and expensive government is that at any given point in time, something is going very wrong, and something is going very right. In hindsight, it is almost always possible to find someone in the bureaucracy who saw the problem coming, and someone in the bureaucracy who ignored the call to action. This topic is too broad to go into in one essay. In fact, I wrote a book on this called Why Presidents Fail and How They Can Succeed Again. The book was published just as Trump got elected, but the Trump presidency and the Biden presidency have suffered the same fate as the two presidents I discussed. In all instances, the White House was so far removed from the federal agencies in charge that they failed to see the weaknesses that made the crisis response worse than it should have been. Whether or not implementation failures are more prevalent in the 21st century than they were in previous eras of U.S. history is a tough question. The argument can be made that the failed rescue mission in Iran during Jimmy Carter's hostage crisis effectively sealed his loss in the 1980 election. But Ronald Reagan, George H.W. Bush, and Bill Clinton managed most of the next two decades without the types of implementation crises that have been discussed here. Another plausible explanation is that the first three...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.